Hi, I'm Thomas. I'm a software developer here at Envision, and I also happen to be my team's Scrum Master. So today I would like to talk about something that we are doing wrong here at Envision. And I'm also going to explain why we are doing it the way we are doing it. So recently I came across this quote from the Scrum Master training manual. It says, "It is possible for a single person to be both the Scrum Master and a member of the development team. However, this is not recommended." In other words, do not try this at home. I assume some of you aren't that familiar with the Scrum framework, or maybe don't know what exactly a Scrum Master is supposed to do, so I will try to clarify it a little bit across my talk. If there are any open questions, I'm here around after the session, so if you have more questions, just go ahead and ask me. But for now, to understand why we are doing it this way and why I'm in this position, it helps to have a look at Envision's history. So Envision was founded in 1995, and back then it was a typical old school software company. So we had strong management in place. There were a lot of hierarchically structured organization with management structures and the like. And the software development happened in some kind of waterfall-like workflow. Actually, this was pretty common back then. You had product managers which would sit together and came up with a battle plan where they laid out specifications on how the software was supposed to be developed in the next half year or year or so, and then this would get handed to the developers and they would continue work along these specifications for the months to come. Yeah, back then this was pretty normal. By now, it's widely accepted that this is not the best way of developing software. You are not able to adapt to frequent changes, and it's a rather rigid model, and it also brings with it some issues that we also observed here at Envision. So we built up a huge pile of technical debt as our software got more and more complex and bigger. Development slowed down more and more, and we were not able to meet our own requirements. And we also saw an increasing number of bugs and other defects like usability issues or performance issues. So when around 2011, Envision shifted its focus, we tried to get away from our on-premise software and move on to the cloud to offer our workforce management solution as a software as a service platform. We figured it might be time to move away from this rigid old way of developing software and becoming more agile. So there are several ways to implement agile software development, and after some research, we decided we would go with the Scrum framework. So Scrum basically is a process framework which consists of a few well-defined rules that make sure you don't make big mistakes, because you have these rules in place and they tell you how to work, and this can be adopted to most software development problems you have. And actually, this turned out to work quite well for us. After about 1.5 years, we had several Scrum teams in place, which were able to launch a successful cloud solution for our software. And we were shipping features fast, and we were also able to reduce our bugs. However, after 1.5 years, we also felt like maybe it's time to move on. We understood how agile software development was meant to be, and we understand what we are doing, and we have the Scrum framework in place with these rigid rules, and we feel like they are holding us back. We would like to continue doing agile development, but we will try to advance from Scrum and do our own implementation of agile development. At the same time, there was a general movement at Envision. We wanted to make the company more lean in general. So we got rid of a lot of management infrastructure, and people would drop their titles. And there was also a tendency to reduce the number of different roles within the company. So together with moving away from the Scrum framework, we also got rid of the roles of product owner and Scrum Master back then. So we still had the teams. We didn't do Scrum anymore, and we found we had another issue. What we are doing all the time with the Scrum and also with the teams that we had after that was that we were doing some kind of local optimization. We always try to improve the output of every single team, but there was no global perspective on this. So what was missing was optimizing the output of the whole company and the teams working together. We also try to address this, so we dissolved this team, and the whole development department in Düsseldorf became one big team, the DUSDEV development team. That led to a situation that climaxed around 2016, where we were doing was something that's also sometimes referred to as California Agile, where developers do whatever they want and you get whenever delivery. So coincidentally, this was also the time when I joined Envision. I joined in May 2016. And what I found here was there were very skilled developers at work and very bright individuals in general at Envision. But to be honest, we were not able to ship a lot of working software. We were not able to deliver a valuable product or valuable product increments to our customers in regular intervals. So obviously that was something we needed to address. And this time we decided we might need some help, and we hired two agile coaches to help us with the situation. So we sat together with our coaches and we identified three areas of concern. The first was a technical view of not being able to deliver software, but even though we had some minor issues there that we found, overall, we felt we were doing quite well in this regard. We were doing test-driven development. We have started building up a microservice architecture. We were doing continuous deployment, so we were able to deliver software from a developer's machine into production where a customer could work with it in 3 to 5 minutes. So that wasn't that bad, and we decided to put this hotspot on the back burner and focus on two other areas. The first being the product viewpoint. When we departed from Scrum and got rid of the product owner role, what we also lost was a clear vision regarding our software. So developers were supposed to come up with ideas on how to improve our products, and yeah, we tried hard. But there was no real ownership of this perspective, and we didn't really know what the customers needed and what improvements they would want from our software, so this didn't work really well. The other hotspot we identified was the process. The process we had back then was that every 2 weeks we would have a retrospective, we would analyze what happened the last 14 days, talk about what went good, what went bad, what we might improve. Yeah, we had regular groomings where we discussed possible new features and assigned them to certain developers. We did estimations, how long this might take, and most of the time the estimations were completely off. And that was about all we had in terms of a process. So we created two task forces, one dealing with the product issue, one dealing with the process view. And I became part of the process view task force. We discussed the issues at hand with our coaches, and what we found was that maybe when we departed from Scrum, that was too early, that it was time to take a step back and once more try ourselves at Scrum, because we still could benefit from this framework, even if it consists of a set of rather rigid rules. So we once again, we created some Scrum teams. These became four teams, the Codefathers, Team Forecast, Team 42, and the Lannisters. We tried to set up these teams in a cross-functional way, so every team was able to do the full stack that was required to ship working software. Every team got a back-end developer, a front-end developer, UX person, some got UI designers, and of course, according to the Scrum framework, every team would get a product owner and a Scrum Master. We took the product owners from the product view task force and the Scrum Masters. It felt natural to take them from the process view group, so I became Scrum Master for the Codefathers team. To allow our new product owners and Scrum Masters a smooth transition towards their new role, we decided they would do this role with 50% of their capacity, and they could remain in their comfort zone, basically, with the other 50%. So I became a 50% Scrum Master and stayed 50% developer and ended up in this team. Here we had a very special solution because the team Codefathers ended up with two guys from the product view group. So we had two 50% product owners here. And that didn't feel too well to the team. And after only 2 months, we decided we should change this here. So the backend developer product owner became a 100% product owner. And the UX product owner decided to become a full-time UX expert for the team again. Me, however, I stayed both Scrum Master and developer. And the same was true for the other Scrum Masters at Envision. We stayed with 50% in both roles. In the beginning I said that I showed you this quote, that this is not recommended, and the literature seems to agree on this, and in fact there are several challenges to this. The first is has to do with the Scrum Master's role. The Scrum Master is supposed to serve three parties. So the Scrum Master should help the development team with implementing Scrum and following the rules. And the Scrum Master coaches this team on how to implement the process and also tries to work with the team to improve the process within the rules of the Scrum framework. So the team gets better basically again and again. But the Scrum Master is also supposed to serve the product owner, to help him with coming up with user stories and grooming with the team, and also to support the product owner's interests inside the team. And finally, the Scrum Master is supposed to serve the organization as a whole, and he should drive changes that help with adopting the Scrum framework and with the acceptance of Scrum in the whole company. So you have three parties here, which have all interests of their own, and the Scrum Master can be seen as some kind of referee for these parties, and has to be impartial. And it's very difficult to be impartial if 50% of your personality resides in one of the affected parties. Then here we have something that happens to me every day. I need to prioritize my efforts. So I always have to decide what I'm going to do right now. Will I hit the keyboard and start coding and write software that we agreed on with the product owner to build? Or should I rather let the rest of the team do the development and focus on improving the process? This decision becomes especially difficult when we are having trouble finishing a sprint as expected and as we committed to the product owner. So in this situation, for a developer, it's quite normal to start coding like crazy and trying to finish the software as promised. But especially in this kind of situation, maybe it's better to have someone who observes the process and makes sure everything is still running smooth and we are taking care of the issues we have and analyze why we are in this trouble. So I always need to decide what I'm going to be right now. As a Scrum Master, you're also supposed to be a good observer. So you have to notice when there are issues in your team. This may be technical issues or interpersonal issues, or maybe someone from outside your team is sidetracking your developers. So you are some kind of watchdog and you always need to be on the lookout. But what has happened to me several times is that I was coding on some difficult problem and really thinking into it and typing on the keyboard, looking on the screen. Maybe I was discussing the issue at hand with my pairing partner, and suddenly I looked up and basically my whole team was gone. And I didn't know when they left, where they've gone to. And yeah, I feel I did a pretty bad job at being an observer here. Yeah, and finally, this is something, as a developer, you tend to be to have blind spots towards certain kind of problems. So for example, you have some old part of your software that has always been this ugly legacy beast, and it takes maybe 10, 15 minutes to deploy, while other services, the newer stuff, gets deployed within 1 to 3 minutes. And as a developer, you just take this for granted. It's always been that way, and you don't even notice there is an issue. And in this kind of situations, it helps when someone from the outside, in our case, these are often our agile coaches, have a look on this, because you don't realize it when you are knee-deep in the shit yourself. So as you see, a lot of challenges. Anyway, me and the other Scrum Masters here in Envision decided to accept the challenges. And there were three factors which helped a lot here. First, there was already a lot of agile understanding at the company when we started with this iteration of Scrum. So many people at Envision already knew how to work in an agile way, and we didn't have to do much coaching here towards the company. Also, the product owner in my team when I started, he has been a Scrum Master in the first iteration of Envision Scrum. So he already exactly knew what to do, and there was no coaching required towards the product owner. That made it a lot easier to just focus on the development team. And we had very strong support from our CEO. He supported us in this decision with doing Scrum again, and we also got rid of the management structures long ago, so we didn't have to fight an uphill battle against the management to implement Scrum in the company. That is something that a lot of Scrum Masters have to fight with in other companies. Finally, whenever we have issues that we can't solve as Scrum Masters ourselves, that we don't find a solution to, we still have our agile coaches, and they are always there for us for consulting to find a good solution to problems we can't solve. Okay, on top of these challenges, there are a few benefits. First, doing the Scrum Master role for me was a great opportunity to leave my comfort zone. Actually, I like leaving my comfort zone. I wouldn't be talking in front of 150 people here if I didn't. And yeah, it's a great opportunity for personal development, because you are developing some skill sets that's completely different from what is required of a developer typically. So that was I see it as a great chance. You can also benefit as a developer from doing Scrum Master work, because you are always in this in this mindset. You need to coach people, you need to explain Scrum to other people. Sometimes you need to defend the process. You discuss it with the other Scrum Masters in our Agile Guild. And that helped me adopt this mindset, I think, much faster than a typical developer would do. On the other hand, in the Scrum Master role, I benefited from also being a developer, because you just have better understanding for developers' problems and interests. I know how developers think, I know what troubles they have to fight with every day, and that gives you a lot of empathy for their problems, and it helps build a personal connection to them that is very helpful when you're in such kind of role. Yeah, and the last is related to that. It's simply easier to understand technical impediments that hold a development team back when you have a deep understanding of technical implications and know what's happening behind the scenes. So what about the future? We might continue doing it wrong, and I would try to make improvements in both roles, becoming a better developer and becoming a better Scrum Master all the time. However, this is a little bit in conflict with Envision's values, because at Envision we say we strive for perfection and try to attain mastery. And it's pretty difficult to become a master in two unrelated disciplines at the same time. So maybe this first option actually isn't the best option anymore. A second option would be to hire some dedicated Scrum Masters, so I can become a dedicated developer again. Actually, we do have job openings for the Scrum Master role, so if any of you is a Scrum Master and thinks he might help us at Envision with implementing Scrum, you're welcome, talk to our HR people. Or the final option for me would be to withdraw from the developer role, so I can accelerate the mastery in the Scrum Master role. To be honest, I haven't made up my mind yet on this. I will try to be awesome in the future. That's it from me. If you like my talk, I would be happy if you follow me on Twitter, and I'm here for discussion. Thank you very much.